Hey guys, my name is Nick. I flew all the way from the Netherlands to bring you this talk. I run a small web development company called WebHub with a friend of mine, and I'm currently finishing my computer science master at the University of Twente. You can find me on GitHub, on Twitter, on my own website. So, I too started a side project 6 months ago, and I wanted to create an Ember app in the browser, which felt as much as a native app as possible. I took an experimental approach to this, as I didn't really know what was possible yet. So what I did was create an app, build things, and when they grew enough, I put them into separate add-ons, and I'm going to show you today what made the cut. So, first things first, I initialized a new Ember app, of course. I installed some of my favorite tools, SAS and Ember Bootstrap, just to get things going quickly. And then I thought, hey, what do we actually need to create an app-like experience? So there's a few basic UI elements that most apps have, like toolbars, either bottom or top. Bars, side menus, especially on Android, they're really common. Panes through which you can pan. And then also the pan gesture support. App-like transitions, that's a really important part in the actual app experience. And scroll state management. So then I started looking into the Ember ecosystem, of course. I opened up Ember Observer and took a look at what's actually available. One of the most important things I installed first was Ember Gestures, which is a gesture wrapper around the Hammer.js gesture library. It provides easy integration for gestures in Ember components. Then, of course, we all heard about it yesterday, Ember Animated for cool transitions. And then I took a look at a few of the sidebar add-ons available. Ember Burger Menu is one of the most well-known ones, but it didn't really provide what I was looking for. It has some basic gesture support where you can swipe to open, but not actually drag. Ember Side Menu is actually one that does that, but I discovered it too late, and it didn't support, or it I had already solved a few problems in my own add-on, which would still be there with this add-on. So the first component I created was a toolbar component. Apps usually have either a fixed bar at the top, at the bottom, or both. The rest of the screen is then filled with a scrollable viewport where the content of the app is visible. The bars can be in the context of the page, so that when you animate into a new context, the bars animate with the page. Now, in the browser, this is a little harder. During my experimentation, I found that using the body as the scrolling element was the most reliable way to actually implement these bars. And this means the bars must be position fixed, which later brought along a new problem, which is actually a limitation of the CSS standard covering this. That standard is that a position fixed element within an element which has a CSS transform is actually not positioned relatively to the window anymore, which completely destroys the purpose of position fixed because it's now not stuck to the top of your window anymore. So this means we must actually define these bars high up in the DOM so we can prevent this, as we'd like to add cool animations which actually use transform to the pages. So the actual component, I created a wrapper component which manages the bars. You can yield either a top or a bottom bar from this wrapper component. And what you get is then this. You can see that it's a little different from the app version, as the scroll bar is actually covering the entire viewport. The wrapper will adjust its spacing to accommodate for the space the bars take up, so that your content will always be visible. And then there's another cool feature which mobile bars can have in apps, which I also ported over. And that's actually that the bar auto-hides on downward scroll and comes back into view immediately when you scroll up again. As you can see in the video. You can optionally set the collapsible height of the top bar so that you can create a double row menu-like thing where only the top part collapses, so the menu stays in view all the time. This also works for the bottom bar. It works in an inverse way, so when you scroll down, that will collapse to the bottom. Then onto the sidebar menu. So this is actually a very common way to do menus in websites. You get a hamburger button in the most annoying position possible. And the menu items are also still in a pretty hard to reach place. On Android, this is actually solved pretty nicely. They pull down the menu items a little bit so you can reach them easier. The menu is a full height scrollable menu on the left side or the right side. And there's a mask which closes the menu. Then this menu also has gesture support, so you can pan from the edge to open it. And you can pan on the menu to close it. So if you start your pan on the mask, it will not actually trigger the panning action until you reach the side menu. And you can, of course, also swipe it with a high enough velocity to either close or open it. This, again, is a wrapper component from which you can yield the menu. You can ask it for a side. Both left and right are supported, as I said before. And then also an extended link to component is provided, which closes the menu when you transition into a new route. Then how does the edge pan recognition work? Because our wrapper is actually defined high up in the DOM, so the entire element will get pan recognition events. Basically what I did was check if there's any menu defined, whether it's open or not. And if it's not, then I check the edges, check whether or not the pan start event is within the edges, and then set it active. Now, those of you with an iPhone might think, hey, I already have an edge gesture in my browser, and that's true. This conflicts with the browser's pan to go back, causing some very funky behavior. And unfortunately, we can't use edge gestures in the iOS browser. So we have to detect them when we are in a browser environment on iOS. The pan to go back gesture is actually disabled in when you add the app to the home screen. So we can use Ember User Agent, which is a nice add-on, to actually detect the iOS environment, and then use the window.navigator.standalone property, which is Safari specific, to detect whether or not we are running from home. Now when we add this to our pan start event, it won't trigger on iOS in the browser environment. For Chrome and Firefox, there's a similar work in progress standards called display mode standalone, which you can also use to detect a standalone browser. Then finally, what you get is this menu. As you can see, the pan event nicely closes the menu. Next up is the pane. This is actually the most complex component I created. It has there's two basic features I wanted to support. So first up, there's the tab-like component through which you can pan. You can put arbitrary content in the templates. This does mean you cannot span between routes. So the best we can do here is use query parameters to actually keep the state of the tabs. And then the other thing I wanted to do was pan between resource routes. So you have routes, like in this case, a posts route, where the template is the same, but only the model differs. And we can actually pan between those. Then the components for the, there's again a wrapper component, which manages the entire component. You can yield a navigation from it, which I will show later, and then put in the panes in the scroller. You can add a title, which will show up in the navigation, and add your content there. The infinite panes work a little bit differently. You provide a previous model, a current model, and a next model, either of which either the previous and or the next model can be null. And then that's it. You can now pan between routes. And then I had an idea. There's actually another way we can use this. A carousel is basically a set of panes with limited interaction and time change. So we just need to add a simpler indicator with the nice dots, which follows the pan movement. And then use the famous Ember concurrency to add a task, yielding a timeout of 5 seconds, and then changing to the new pane. We start this task when we insert the component, and then when the user interacts with it, we interrupt the task. And when either the mouse leaves or the touch ends, we restart the task again, and now we have a carousel. Then I was like, yay, everything works, I'm going to play with this. But, yeah, this is a new problem showed up, which you can see here. That's not good. And I was like, oh no, what am I going to do? yeah, and we've all seen Maurice talk about events. Luckily for me, this is actually when the browser worked with me. There's actually another phase in the whole event system, which is the capture phase, that traverses down the DOM to the element that on which the event happened. And then you get the bubble phase, which you probably all know, which then handles the event. We can actually use this capture phase, but Ember works after the bubble phase, so we can't use Ember events. And Ember gestures, unfortunately, doesn't support the capture phase. So this is when I thought, oh no, now, what do I do now? And this is actually when I started to write my own pen recognizer, so I could make use of all this. So basically, what is a pen recognition? What you need is basically touch events, which are supported by all modern browsers. And you need, on each touch event, you need the coordinates, the angle, the distance, and the velocity of the movement. So we want to enable the capture phase optionally, because usually you'd still like to use the bubble phase, for example, when you have nested panes or whatever. And we want to provide a locking service. Now back to the side menu, we will implement this new pen recognizer. And this happens through a mix-in. We enable the capture events for the side menu. And then we will claim the lock on a valid edge pen. So this way, there will no pen events will happen on any other add-on using Ember Mobile Core. And now everything works as expected. This also enables nested panes. So what you see here is actually a higher level pane, multi-pane with the menu up top, and a nested carousel which will seamlessly flow over into the parent pane when you reach the edge. Also note the navigation at the top. It follows, it keeps the active item in the view so the user always knows where he is, and the indicator morphs between menu items. Then the next important part, transitions with Ember Animated. Why do we want transitions? Well, when used correctly, transitions will enhance the perceived responsiveness of a mobile app and will also unconsciously or consciously inform the user of the context he is in. This is an example transition I've created, which is inspired by iOS. And what you see here is that the title of the previous page morphs into the back button, and the new title flies in. The new page will also slide over the old page, and the old page slides away slightly. Now, this is where I thought, hey, mobile transitions follow route hierarchy and context in a predictable way. So we can abstract this into a component. So just to remind you all, this is what a normal Ember route hierarchy looks like. We have posts, then a detail page for a single post, and an edit route. And what you'll notice is that with each of these, you go one level deeper. And we can actually completely abstract the transitions away. So I've created a mobile page component. This component is aware of route transition direction using the an application route mixin. It will select the matching transition effect, and it will manage page and viewport style during transition, which is harder than you might think. It also manages the scroll state. Currently, it supports horizontal transitions between similar level panes or pages, and the transitioning down and transitioning up the route hierarchy. And in the near future, we will also support switching to an out-of-flow context or to a new context. This is basically the animation you get when you create a new post, for example, and then the page flies up from the bottom. The top toolbar functions in a similar way to the mobile page. This is also a component I created. This component is meant to be used in a top toolbar. It provides several Ember Elsewhere portals to which you can send left buttons, titles, right buttons, and a second row of content, in the middle case, the navigation. And this component transitions on the same based on the same rules as the mobile page component. Now, managing scroll state. For the scroll state, we can actually use the route hierarchy again, as it's quite clear how scroll state works in mobile apps. It should basically get restored when you're going up in the route hierarchy or sideways, and get reset when you go back down. But we used document-based scrolling, and with all these transitioning elements, it's actually quite hard to manage this scroll state, as the transitioning elements are not actually the scrolling elements. During transition, the body size must actually be limited to prevent any weird scroll bars appearing during the transition. And we apply the scroll state as a CSS transform during this transition. Normally we'd use memory scroll or Ember Router Scroll, which are two well-known add-ons to manage scroll state. But in this case, we can't. So mobile page will manage that by itself. As you can see, the scroll state gets properly applied and restored as we go back and forth. The infinite scroller component has a similar approach, but it uses its own scroll state management. Then responsiveness. So we have a few tools we can use to create to make our app responsive in the web sense. There's Ember Responsive, in which you can define a set of breakpoints. In this case, I've defined the default Bootstrap 4 breakpoints. And you can then, in your template, add an if check to see to render something only on mobile, for example. But this may cause flicker when using fastboot, as fastboot is not actually aware of the screen size you have. Luckily, there's another approach, and that's the CSS media queries you probably all know. And Bootstrap has some useful utilities to find out, to apply styles to the different breakpoints. And there's also some utility classes we can use. Now there's an example over here. The settings menu, this is the index route of the settings menu containing the items. And this is then a nested route with settings pages. But this is probably not what you'd like on desktop. There's a lot more space. You don't want to show just the menu with a few items. So how are we going to solve this? We can move the settings menu into a component and render it on the settings index route as well as the settings route on desktop. And then you get the page as shown on the slide. But we cannot actually use the settings.index route anymore on desktop. So we'll have to redirect users when they're on desktop. We can, again, use the Ember Responsive utility to do that. And then transitions. Yeah, we put in those transitions. This doesn't really look nice on desktop. Turns out mobile transitions don't work well on desktop. So we'll have to turn them off. We can use Ember Responsive to disable or modify these transitions. So I created a computed property checking whether or not transitions should be enabled. And then in the template, just disable the complete animation if we're not on mobile. Then final remarks. We've seen a lot of great progressive web app-oriented things on this conference. And those are, of course, very important when creating a mobile app. You can add splash screens, icons, offline availability, native notifications, and the add-to-home notification. Then there's also hybrid apps, for which this will also work really well. This basically means you put the Ember app into an installable web view. Then the final things you need to keep in mind. You must keep or will likely run into some problems when you're following default Ember the default Ember router style. As you might know, model hooks completely block rendering. And as such, also the visual transition. And on mobile, it's not really nice when you click an item, have to wait a couple of seconds, then a transition happens. It kind of breaks the experience. But there's some great resources on how to apply Ember concurrency based patterns to make the model hook async, or use a loader component to asynchronously load the data. I've put links to these resources in the demo app repository. Then I kept this one in too. It's quite important, and it might also nicely finish your EmberConf bingo. It's the swelled list rendering. Rendering takes a lot of time, and especially during transitions, performance may suffer when there's a lot of items on screen. There's actually a great add-on called Vertical Collection to improve on this situation. Then, is there still time left? Yeah, there's some time left. So this is the finished app then. As you can see, we have the side menu here. We can throw it around. There's the carousel. When we move here, we have our nested pages with the animations. These will keep scroll state. Oh, I'm actually completely on the other side. Here you can see the nested panning in action. And you can actually just touch scroll this navigation bar. I made no modifications there. That's just a div which is scrollable. Here are the nested panes. And the settings menu I showed before. Yeah, and it's all completely responsive. So you can try this yourself. I put the demo app online. Be sure to do so. Report any glitches. And the four add-ons I've shown are available as alpha quality versions on GitHub. Yeah, and that was it. Thank you very much.